How can you describe love, passion, and a burning desire to create with words? Tony was all those things. Like a magical moment, he was an experience that defies the power of language to express. Not perfect, but always fresh. What a gift it is to know someone for many years and still have no idea what will come out when he opens his mouth to speak. Work and love were the anchors in Tony's life. Perhaps from an early childhood, during which he spent several years in an orphanage, Tony developed intense feelings, a tendency for periods of solitude, and a vivid inner world. His imagination was insatiable, sparking off the most basic moments of the everyday. He rode that imagination to great heights of creativity. Yet sometimes it left him exhausted and plagued by dark despair. When Tony was about 8, his grandfather brought him from the orphanage in Lawrence, Massachusetts, to live with him in Brockton. Tony's mother's family had come from Lithuania, and they owned and ran the Kilkus Bakery. Often, Tony would rise at 2 or 3 in the morning to lay the wood fires in the ovens, and then cook breakfast for the bakers before heading off to school. Throughout his life, Tony was fond of saying that the huge loaves of Kilkus black bread had been named best bread in Boston. From his earliest years, Tony was fascinated by airplanes and by flying. He built model airplanes and flew them with friends in and near Brockton. He dreamed of joining the Air Force Academy and, as I understand it, passed the exam. Then came the physical. After climbing up ropes and performing other feats of strength, Tony thought he was in, but there was crushing news. He had never had an eye examination. His vision was nearsighted, and he could never fly jets. His dream dissolved before his eyes. Tony joined the army. He walked from Germany to Paris on leave, and he returned home to study philosophy at Boston University on the GI Bill. There he met and married Laurie Jo Weisbord, whose family had owned the land where the Woodstock Festival was held. They moved to Manhattan, and they joined the New York City art scene revolving around Andy Warhol, Julian Schnabel, and others holding court at Max's Kansas City in Lower Manhattan. Soon after, Tony and Laurie Jo divorced, and Tony moved to Paris. In Paris, Tony began the work that would illuminate his life. He opened a storefront studio in the Rue Vercingétorix near Montparnasse. Almost immediately, his work gained recognition. His sculptures were shown in solo shows at Galerie Faraday-Cadeau and at the Musée d'Art Moderne de la Ville de Paris in 1977, as well as, and especially, at the Centre Pompidou in 1979. After Alexander's death, Tony and Beatrice separated. Later, Tony came to the United States and began what would be the longest stay since his school days in the country of his birth. Tony and I were introduced then by mutual friends on Long Island. He attempted first to move his work to America so that we could live together, but insurance presented an insuperable barrier. In Europe, he could work in steel or metalworking factories, but in America, his presence boosted insurance rates, and it was prohibitive. Tons of steel, cranes, experimenting with balance, it was truly dangerous work. So Tony created his designs in the United States at our homes in Ann Arbor and Cambridge, and then in Santa Barbara. And he built them at his factory in Austria. Along with airplanes, Tony was all his life drawn to jazz. It was the improvisation that intrigued him, how one musician would play and spark a response by another musician that was in some way related, but yet for each uniquely his own. After Alexander's death, Tony slowly began to summon the energy that had deserted him for some months. He began like the jazz musician with riffs, little progressions that one repeats and varies. In fact, he started with threes. Now the number of the little family after Alexander's death. He also developed a coded style in which signs signaled persons or events. Tony developed first some wall pieces. Though he never said what his pieces meant, it seems to me that one can find, along with the extraordinary play of forms, a meditation on the fractured family. The backdrop of one of the premier wall pieces is a circle, perhaps life, broken in one place. Depicted in front of the circle are a strip of steel with a braided pattern, perhaps signaling Beatrice's wavy hair. Next to the straight piece stands a square, a symbol Tony often used for himself. A square with a hole in the middle, an emptiness. Connecting the two pieces which now do not fit together is a ribbon of steel, the symbol of Natalie, their daughter, still linking them. In front, dominating all, is a long, sharp chip of steel, perhaps the little son whose memory now dominates the family. This was one of Tony's most successful series in terms of sales. He said they flew out of the studios. Persuaded that all was not lost, Tony began work on a major monumental piece that he called Epistrophe. It stands now in England in a botanical garden. Building on the theme of threes, he created a work on that theme. Epistrophe means repetition for formal artistic effect. Meditating on threes, Tony created an image which is powerful and unsettling. To my thinking, it's an image of the small family, the three that remain, being torn apart in the aftermath of Alexander's death. The work, which weighs 2.5 tons, has 4 main parts. Against all odds, it stands upright, mostly by the balanced weight of each piece against the others. Only 5 bolts, perhaps symbolizing the 5 years of Alexander's life and of the family's time together, hold the work together at its base. Epistrophe appeared in Eisen 89 in Zurich, one of the most important Swiss sculpture exhibitions of the late 20th century. Tony's work appeared with all the great Swiss artists, Jean Tanguay, Niki de Saint-Phalle, Suter, Wigley, Honegger, and others. The same year, he was invited to exhibit in Exposition Suisse de la Sculpture, again with a pantheon of greats. In 1991, he was invited to the Burgdorfer Bildhauer Symposium, where artists installed a work each over a week or two, eating and socializing together. This was one of Tony's favorite types of events. He often spoke of talks with his friend Paul Widmer in those days. Here, Tony exhibited Sylvianum, a large steel frame in the shape of a cube. It was also a beautiful wind chime. Tony, it seems, had studied techniques used to make cowbells. The chime had a low, throaty, sonorous sound that could be heard for miles. Great French art critic Marcellin Pleynet understood Tony's work perhaps best of all. Pleynet spoke of Tony as creating an ideogramme d'un récit, a picture of a story. The works, he tells us, establish and reconceive an imaginary space, in which process the parts of the whole reconstitute themselves. Pleynet observed that Tony Long experimented to create forms of balance and support, at times, it seemed, against all odds in new ways. He compared Tony Long's work to Rodin. But Tony Long was above all a man, a lover, father, and friend. As Louis Azikoff said at the memorial for Tony at St. Bartholomew's Chapel and then the Harvard Club of New York City, his life was a wandering and a coming home, a life filled to the brim with love and good fortune, as well as deep pain and loss. A life of intense vitality, artistic accomplishment. A life of almost heroic thirst for knowledge and experience that was, as a friend said, like the life of 10 men. He drank life deeply. Not a day goes by that those of us who knew Tony Long well do not think of him with love. Authenticity, brilliance, humor, warmth, darkness and light. Ami, inspirateur, compagnon, amour, Tony Long.